Good morning, everyone. Now, what you have in your bulletin and what we'll be talking about is slightly there and slightly not there. Isaiah 55:1. And that's only because some of the things, when they ask me, what are you going to preach about? Sometimes you can't all, you know, people are so used to ready-made messages. But let me just say this to you. There are times when the Holy Spirit will not give you a message until you get there. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we bow before thee because without you we can do nothing. And without you I can do nothing. Your people have come to assemble on your day of rest. We pray you help us relish it while we can, because our freedoms are leaving this country. And we realize that soon our religious freedom will be under attack. Father, we ask that you will please give us understanding of the scriptures and grant us thy Holy Spirit. And we address our prayer to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, where Jesus now ever liveth as our high priest in the most holy place of that heavenly sanctuary. And we ask for the Holy Spirit, and we thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit right now by faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Turn me to Psalms 23, a psalm that you're familiar with, but a psalm that has a much more deeper meaning than what is seen on the surface. All right, Psalms 23. When you get there, just say amen. Are you there? All right. The Bible says, and I'm looking at verses 4 and 5. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Now, I want you to see something now. We're going to look at that, and we're going to see how this Psalms can connect with Isaiah 55:1. Go to Isaiah 55:1 with me. Come on. Isaiah 55:1. Keep your finger in Psalms 23. Do not lose that page. You'll be right back there in a little bit. All right? In Isaiah 55:1, the Bible says, Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the what, everybody? Waters. And ye that have no money, come buy and what? Eat. Wherefore, verse 2, do you spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which is satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Now, the Bible says here in Psalms 23, let's go there first, Psalms 23, David said, yea, though I walk through the what? Through the valley of the shadow of death. Now, most people look at this psalm and they use it for a funeral. This psalm is not a funeral. Most preachers at funerals use this psalm when they're taking the body out. Yea, I walk through the valley of the shadow. Remember, the body is not being taken out, it's being carried out. He's not walking out, all right? That shows, first of all, that the psalm is not for the dead. The psalm here, Psalm 23, is for the living. All right? Because the dead person is in the coffin. He knows nothing. He hears nothing. He sees nothing. He doesn't even know he's being rolled out and being put in the grave. You understand me? So this psalm is for the what? The living. Let's take a look. Yea, do I walk. Now, David says, yea, do I walk. But what does it mean to walk? The first time walk is used in Scripture is found in Genesis chapter 5. In Genesis chapter 3. When Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, look what Genesis chapter 3 had to say. Now, listen carefully. Genesis chapter 3. And when you get there, just say amen. I'm trying to go slow, so I won't go too fast for you this time around, all right? All right, Genesis chapter 3, the Bible says here, and I'll start with verse, we'll read the scenario for a moment so you can get the whole picture. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, have God said, Ye may eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die, for God doeth know in the day you eat thereof, your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw the tree was good for food, and pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also to her husband, and he did eat. And it says here, And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Notice it said they heard the voice of the Lord God doing what? Walking. Now, does a voice walk? You ever seen a voice walk? So this has to be a metaphor of some type, isn't that right? So therefore, the issue is not walking, but the issue is that God was desiring communion and conversation with Adam and Eve. One of the things that people do when they come to church is they come to church sometimes to get rid of a guilty conscience. But at the same time, they also run from the voice of God that is calling them for conversation to settle their guilt. And many times, the Spirit of God is speaking to them in the pews, bringing conviction across their mind, and then they try to play it off, walk it off, or hurry up and get out the church. Or they say, I don't like what that preacher said, and I'm never coming back here again. Some even go that far. But the issue is not the preacher in reality. The issue is the convicting power of the Spirit of God, convicting them sometimes on a pet sin or a pet thought or idea or doctrine that have held, but at the same time have not studied into it. And the Spirit of God brings conviction to them. And they don't like the convicting power, so therefore they try to play it off. You know, I've seen it a lot of times with young people as well as with adults. But let's go one more step further. The Bible said the voice of the Lord God was what? Walking in the garden. So God was asking for what? What does walking here indicate? Communing with God, all right? So what is communion? What do you mean when you say commune with God? Is it God just talking to you? Or is it just you talking with God? Or is it you and God together having a conversation about your life? And about your problems, and about your trials, and about your hopes and your fears. In the book Steps to Christ, it says, keep your wants, your joys, your fears, your cares before God. You cannot burden him. You cannot weary him. He who numbers the hairs on your head. How many hairs do you have on your head? Can you count them lately? You know, I can't even, my wife, when she combs her hair and she pulls all the hair out, I never took time to count it. I think I'd be there all day. And still wouldn't be able to finish. But at the same time, he who numbers the hairs on your head is not indifferent to the wants of his what? Children. So the Bible makes it very plain that when we commune with God like we should, we will not just talk about what we want. We will talk about our fears. We will talk about our cares. We will talk about the burdens that that affect us at that day. And we will also talk to God about our sin. And the habits that, or the temptation, or that one that so easily beset us that we keep fighting with. And we'll be asking for power to put away our sin. You see, prayer does not bring God down to us, but it brings us into the presence of God. And therefore, prayer is how we get into the sanctuary. We get there by faith and by what? Prayer. Faith takes God at his what? Word. Prayer does not bring God down to us, but it brings us up to God. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that every time you pray, your prayer ascends, but your prayer comes into the presence of God? You say, well, I'm messed up. I'm a sinner. I've done a lot of things I shouldn't have done. You sure have. But at the same time, that prayer can still go up to God. Does God hear a sinner's prayer? If he didn't, Jesus couldn't have died on the cross for you. Because the Bible said he died to save you from what? Sin. All have what? Sinned and come short of the glory of God. If he hadn't heard a sinner's prayer, I would not be here today talking with you. Now, the problem is, after you were born again and you accepted Christ, now you have an understanding that says this: if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear my prayer. But what's the condition on that? This is now when I have what? Accepted Christ, and I understand the conditions by which God will answer prayer and give me power to overcome. You understand what I'm telling you now? Now remember, Proverbs 28:9, what does the Bible say about that? There's only a few conditions where God doesn't hear prayer. Think about it. If I regard iniquity in my heart, God will not hear my what? Prayer. But let's go one more step further. The Bible says over in Proverbs 28:9, he that turn away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer is a what? Abomination. So if I purposely turn from God's commandments to do what I want to do and just really rebel, outright rebel against his commandments, will he hear my prayer? What's blocking my prayer? Transgression of his what? Law, which goes back to the issue of iniquity. Isn't that right? So the Bible makes it very plain again. So, but now let's go one more step further. So let's see what else it means to walk. Turn to Genesis chapter 5. Genesis chapter 5, we'll see it again. Genesis chapter 5, we see it one more time. We're talking about Psalms 23, by the way, for those who look. Genesis chapter 5, and look here at verse 22. The Bible says in Enoch, what everybody? Enoch walked with God after he begot Methuselah 300 years and begot sons and daughters. And the Bible says, verse 24, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God what? God took him. So walking with God has something to do with communication to such a degree that you can have such a relationship with Jesus that you can actually be translated from this world to the next and perhaps not see death. If you would commune with God. Walking with God is communion with God. Do you desire that? People come to church, but people don't commune with God. People want to hear a sermon, but they don't want to make their life the sermon, where their life has a constant connection with Jesus Christ. That's the most important thing. One day the church doors will close. What will you do then? Will you worry about then what you wear? Will you worry about what you have on? Will you worry about what the elders think of you then? When the doors of this church will finally close because of persecution and religious intolerance, what will you do then? Will you have a communion with God that is solid? Do you talk with God in your bedroom? Do you make your house become a palace for prayer and for the study of God's word? Do you make your life every day? Do you seek to try to bring your mind, your heart into harmony with God? Because you and I got to learn that prayer is not a certain place all the time. Prayer is where you are at that moment, where you desire to commune with God. You ought to pray every moment, every second of the day we ought to be praying. Yes, sir, you had a fit?
Is that the same as Amos 3:7?
Amos 3:7? Two can't walk together except they agree. That's dealing with, you can say that in a sense, but that's referring to two people on earth. But you can't, but the only thing about God is you can disagree with God, and yet he will not leave you. He will still try to reach you, especially if he recognizes your ignorance. So sometimes when you're in deliberate rebellion, you ever get to a point where, or I've seen people say, well, something like this. I'll give you an example. Jeremiah was a preacher for God, wasn't he? What did Jeremiah say one day? He said, I'm through. I refuse to talk about you anymore. Now, was he agreeing with God at that point? Or was he in disagreement with God? He was in disagreement because God was giving him a bunch of what? Trials and difficulty that put him in what? Prison for speaking the words of God. But then Jeremiah said something else though later. God knew him better. He said, the word of God became like what? Fire in his what? Bones. You also have the story of Elisha, who ran from Jezebel and hid in a cave. Was that God's will for him to run to a cave? No. But what happened? In the cave, the Lord looked at Elijah and said, what doest thou here? It wasn't a wind, it wasn't a storm, it was a still small voice. Even at times when we are in rebellion against God, after we have come into a knowledge of knowing Him, sometimes when we're thinking we're through, there are some of us who say, Lord, just kill me. I just want to die. I don't want to live like this any longer. But God doesn't kill you. He doesn't let you die. Why? That's a loving kindness. And that loving kindness is given not just to Christians, but to all mankind. So that loving kindness shows that no matter, even at times when we were in the world, when we cursed God and said we would have nothing else to do with Him. Some of us blame God for our parents dying, or a grandparent, or whatever we had. But at the same time, God did not give up on us. And so I want to bring that out. But let me go back here now for just a moment. Look what the Bible said. Now, I brought this out because of where we're going in Psalms 23. David said, I walk through the valley of the shadow. What is the valley of the shadow of death?
Death.
What is the valley of the shadow of death? David says, though I walk. Now remember, he's in communion with God, day by day, prayer and what? Bible study. He says, but that's how you walk with God, through prayer and Bible study on a day by day basis. Yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. What's the shadow of death talking about? Turn me to Isaiah 9:2. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2. And the Bible says in Isaiah 9:2, let's see what the valley of shadow of death is, all right? The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2, the people that walked in darkness have seen a great light, and they that dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them has light shined. Did everybody catch that? What did the Bible say the shadow of death was? Let's go a little closer. Look what it says. Look at your Bible. See, we read this psalm only in the idea that David's a little shepherd boy out in the wilderness somewhere playing his harp. But this psalm is dealing with relevancy for our time. And at the same time, God expects you to understand the spiritual connotations behind Psalms 23 as well as the outward physical connotation of the chapter. Look what it said. It says, that they that dwelt, looking at the second part of Isaiah 9:2, they that dwelt where? In the land of the shadow of death, saw what everybody? It says, the shadow of death, upon them has light what? Shine. Now, that's one text. That was Isaiah 9:2. Turn me to Jeremiah 2:6. Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 6. Let's look at it again. Jeremiah 2:6. In Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 6, notice again what the Word of God says. The Bible says, neither said they, where is the Lord that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, that led us through the wilderness, through the what? Through a land of deserts and of pits, and through a land of drought, and through the shadow of what? It says a land of drought and the shadow of what? The shadow of death. It says, through a land that no man passed through and where no man dwelt. Question, what did the Bible say the shadow of death was now? Because most of you thinking about the graveyard. The Bible said the shadow of death is a land. But now land is also represented by another term. Remember in Genesis chapter 1 when God created the world? The Bible said, God said, let the waters under heaven be gathered together unto one place. And let the what? Dry land appear. And that dry land, and the Bible said, the gathering together waters called he what? Seas. But he called the dry land what? Earth. Yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death? Yea, do I walk through the earth, which is the valley of the shadow of death, or which is overshadowed by sin that brought death. Remember, Romans 6:23 says, the wages of what? Sin is death. Where did death come? Upon our what? Planet. Sin has cast a shadow of death over the planet. David says, through communion with God, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, the earth overshadowed by sin and death, I fear no evil. Are you with me now? This is what he's talking about. Let's go a little bit closer. Everybody get that? That's not hard. It's just that you're not used to looking at Psalms 23 that way. Let's go a little bit closer, though. Look what the Bible says here, going back to Psalms 23. Now, all right, and when you get there, just say amen. That way I know you're there, all right? Are you there yet? Come on. The Bible says, going on, though, it says, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Now, the rod and the staff deals with the issue of God's law and his word. Because the Bible says in Romans, when you talk about comfort, there are two things that comfort you. It says, but he said, that rod and thy, what? Staff, they comfort me. A rod is a scepter of rulership. In fact, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 1, in fact, look at it with me, Hebrews 1, listen, what it, let me show you what, give me this word. Rod, the word rod and scepter are one and the same. And it's dealing with rulership. And here, Hebrews chapter 1, 8, I believe it is, I want. Hebrews 1, 8. But unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God, is what? Forever and ever, a scepter of what? Righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Remember, rod is also is represented as a scepter or for rulership. What is the rulership according to Hebrews 1:8? A scepter of what? Righteousness. And by, he says, unto the Son, he said, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness, or this rulership of your kingdom, is righteousness. Righteousness is used as a what? Scepter. It says here, now watch this very carefully. Going back, he said, also thy rod and thy staff. Staff also can refer, staff in this case is metaphorically used to represent the word of God, because it says about thy rod and thy staff, they what? Comfort me. Do what gives us comfort today? Romans 15:4. Look what Romans 15:4 says about comfort. Romans chapter 15, verse 4. The Bible says, for whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the what? Scriptures might have what? Hope. Now, who else is an agency for comfort? The Bible says in John 14:26, but the Comforter, which is the what? Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance. So when it says thy rod, it's talking about his law. But if we're talking about the staff, it's talking about the word of God. But with the word of God, the comfort that comes out of the word of God is his promises. But the Comforter himself, the Holy Ghost, who's the inspiration behind scriptures, he is the one that brings the real comfort to the mind of men and women who look for God for answers. Are you with me now? So the Bible said, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Now notice the next verse of Psalms 23. What does it say? Read it together. Thou what? Thou preparest a what? A table before me in the presence of my enemies. Now what's a table talking about? Most of the time when you think about a table, you're thinking about a literal table. Let's say this was a table. So you're thinking about a table like this. And then you're thinking about food all on the table. Thou preparest a table in the presence of my enemies. But now there's something about this. Why would God prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemies? Is he trying to show your enemies that he will take care of you? Most of you think like that. But why is God, what type of table, what table is this? Are you saying that God prepared a feast for me in the presence of my enemies? Because that's what most of us use it for, and that's how we translate it. But what does it really say? God prepares a table. Question of all, who is my enemy? Let me give you this. You have two major enemies. One is the devil and his angels, and the other one is death. Did you hear what I said? Two major enemies. The devil and his angels, and death, which is, comes about by sin, if you get the picture. Death is the last enemy, by the way. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 24 will tell you that. But now let's look a little closer for a moment. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, look what the Bible says. For we wrestle not against what? Flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness, where? In high places. Now wait a minute. This spiritual wickedness in high places is also known as the devil and his what? Angels. The angels that kept not their what? First estate were cast out of heaven, right? and bound and brought into chains of what? Darkness. We read about that in 2 Peter 2:4. But now, I think it's 1 Peter 2:4, I think it is. No, 2 Peter 2:4. But let's go a little bit closer. The next point I want to bring out, though, is this. The Bible says here about the issue of your enemies. It says in 1 Peter 5:8, be sober and be vigilant. For your adversary, your enemy is also known as your what? Adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion walketh about, seeking whom he may what? Devour. So God says, I prepared a table for you in the presence of the devil and his angels. I have prepared a table for you in the presence of fallen angels that are out to destroy humanity. Did you get the picture? It's not just about you eating a feast like you're thinking, physical feast. This is spiritual. Because you're in a warfare that's a battle over your mind. If you don't believe the battle's over your mind, then you need to think again. Every time you watch TV, the subliminal messages that come through the commercials are affecting your mind. It affects your decisions. Certain music you listen to affects your mind. Well, what's the purpose of the music? What's the purpose of the television? Well, it's just entertaining, right? I'm able to forget about what's going on around me. I'm able to get rid of my problems. I can just get caught up in a storyline or whatever, and that'll help me, right? No, what you really don't understand is that everything you watch, your subconscious is picking up, and everything is going in here. And a battle is raging in here over who will have control over you. Powers from the outside that you don't see are contending for your mind. Now I want to make it very plain. It's for our minds, all right? This is what the war is over. Whether we want to believe it or not, whether we want to accept it or not, the music we listen to, the subtlety of it. Like for instance, when we listen to jazz music, some Adventists believe they can listen to jazz music and it's okay. But let me help you out though. Jazz has its origin in voodoo music. So I'm sitting in the car, laid back. Let's stop. Now I'm listening to that while I'm driving. It sounds so soothing. I feel so relaxed. But not realizing that the very origin of that music comes out of Vodun, which is voodoo. And that was brought in for the sole purpose of bringing on certain spirits through complex rhythms that are played in the music. But we don't believe that because that can be. But at the same time, music does not get filtered past. Music does not get filtered, so it goes right past your frontal lobes and starts making its way and finding a seat in your brain. And the influences that come with it is telling, especially when guys want to stay up late at night with the young girls, with the friends. Remember that? And they're in the car, oh, yeah, you know, baby, you know. Hey, how's it going, you know? Don't act like you don't know. We all been there. You know, we might be a little older now, sophisticated, but you've been there. And this is what some of the guys would do, and they would play the music, and the girl, and the music is playing, and all the little love songs or whatever is playing. And the whole idea is it has its effect upon the what? The mind. And it brings the girl or the guy both into a seducing effect. Next thing you know, folk talking about getting married. Or they talking about, well, you know, we're going to have to do something because this can't keep going on. All right? But that's the reality. This is a deadly effect. You don't have to believe me. You say, well, I'm in control of myself. You are? If you walk in a grocery store long enough and they play the right music, you'll buy stuff that you weren't intending to buy when you walked in there. Now, I'm talking about the issue of the battle of your mind because the reason why I'm saying this is because there's only one power that's going to be able to deliver you. And the power is at the table. The issue is, what is the table? What is this table he's talking about? Because he prepared a table in the presence of my enemy? Turn me to Isaiah 30, verse 8. Isaiah chapter 30, verse 8. Okay? In Isaiah chapter 30, verse 8. Let's see what the Bible says. The Word of God says in Isaiah 30, verse 8, now go, write it where? Write it before them in a table and note it in a book. that it may be for a time to come and forever and ever. In ancient times, a table was not necessarily known as a four-legged table that you and I put our food on and stuff like that, or have dine, or where we dine at. A table was also known as a writing tablet. Sometimes, if you study ancient hieroglyphics, you will find that many ancient kings engraved everything on tables of stone because it was meant that when it wrote on a table of stone, it was to last forever. God wrote His Ten Commandments on tables of stone, two tables of stone to be exact. A table was a writing tablet. It was also called a book. God says, I prepared a writing tablet, a table for you in the presence of your enemies, or in the presence of the devil and his angels, in the presence of those who would do you harm, in the presence of those who are trying to destroy your mind. What table is this that God has prepared for you and I? The table has to do with writing. Do you know anything that God has written unto you? Has there anything that God has written unto you? Romans 15:4 said, whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the what? Scriptures. So wait a minute. What's the table that God has prepared for you in the presence of your enemy, in presence of the devil and his angels, that can give you power to resist sin, that can give you power to resist temptation, that can give you power to say no? It is the Word of God. That is the table that's prepared for you by God in the presence of your enemies. And the Bible says, with that table, He also put His law there to also strengthen you, not to hinder you, not to make you feel like you're being chained down. I got to keep these commandments. Click, click, like you're in a bunch of chains. No. You're doing this out of love for God. Your love for God leads you to the table. Your desire to be in His presence leads you to the table. That's what you do. But what do you do at a table? What do you do at a normal table? You eat at the table. Does God tell you to eat at the table? Does God tell you? In fact, when dinner comes or when breakfast comes, who usually fixes the breakfast in your house? Usually the mother or the wife or whatever, right? And what does she say to her husband or to the children? What does the mother normally say when everything is ready? She said, no, you know, you go, when your children, someone, when you're in the home, you just say, the food is ready. Or do you say, come and eat. It's time to eat. You ever talk like that? Tell your children it's time to eat? Right. So God prepared a table for you in the presence of His enemies, and He's told you it's time to eat. What you going to eat? The Bible says in Jeremiah 15:16, thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word became unto me a joy and rejoice in my heart, for I am called by thy name, O Lord God of hosts. If you didn't eat for 5 days, you would be almost malnourished while going into the next week. But we can afford not to eat from the Word of God on a daily basis and think we have spiritual nourishment and spiritual discernment and spiritual power to resist sin and everything that comes along. That is incredible. Because every day that you miss at the table is every day that makes you weaker than the day before. And every day that you miss communing with God, it helps your character become more decided for evil than for good. Because there is no opposing spiritual influence that you are inviting to help you resist the evil and the temptations that so easily beset you. And so the Bible says that you must come to the table. I ask you, have you been at the table this morning? Now you don't have to answer it. I'm just asking, have you been at the table? Did you eat at the table this morning? Did you claim promises this morning? Did you believe that God would give you the Holy Spirit when you ask? Did you believe that God will forgive you for your sins? Did you talk with God sometime this week? Did you eat at all at the table this week? Did you find some time when you have to talk with God about something? Even if it would seem to be a little nonsensical to you, it was something that you had to talk about with God. Did you find out that you can talk with your Lord face to face? Did you find that you can spend some time with God at the table? That's all I'm asking this morning. Because the Bible says that God tells you, come and eat. Well, what do you mean, come and eat? But wait a minute. Wait a minute, what do you mean come and eat? In Isaiah 55, the Bible says, Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the what? Waters, and ye that have no money, come buy and eat. Now, what is that talking about? Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the what? Waters? What's that all about? How does that fit into Psalms? Psalms said a table was prepared for you. Isaiah says, come if you're thirsty, come if you're hungry. Where do you come when you're hungry? Where do you go when you're thirsty? You go to a table. I mean, don't you? I do. All right. When you look at me like that, this is your Bible. Your Bible is telling you all this. But let's go one more step further. Ho, everyone that what? Thirsty. What does it mean to thirst? Thirst. Now, wait a minute now. He says, Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. Now, there's two things. There's a thirst, and then he cries out, come to the waters. Now, what are you thirsting? Let's see something. In Revelation, I'm going to say that one for a minute. Let's talk about this for a minute. Thirst. Look at Matthew chapter 5 with me. Matthew chapter 5. And let's look at Matthew chapter 5, and let's see what it means to thirst, all right? Some people, have you ever been thirsty and didn't know? Do you know there are times when your body is thirsty, but you don't know it's thirsty? You think that you need something else to eat, and that's how people get caught up in gaining a lot of weight too, because they said, I just ate about a few hours ago, but I'm still hungry. Did you know that that hunger is not food, but that hunger is water? How much water do you drink a day? If you figure out how much water you drink a day, you can find out what your thirst is all about. But let's go a little bit closer, though. The Bible says here, just looking at this one for a moment, the Word of God says in Matthew chapter 5, the Bible said, blessed, verse 6, blessed are they which do what? Hunger and thirst after righteousness. Now stop. What's the thirst? Righteousness. The thirst is righteousness. Wait a minute. Ho, everyone that thirsteth. Thirst for what? Do you thirst for righteousness? Do you long to do right? Do you long to have the power to do right and stay right? The Bible says, come. Ho ye, everyone that what? Thirst. Now it says, come ye to the what? Waters. Now I'm breaking down as a verse, and then we're gonna put everything together in a few moments. So thirst now is thirsting after what? Righteousness. But what is water?
The Holy Spirit.
Okay, let's take a look. Somebody said the Holy Spirit. Let's see what we have for water. Turn to John 7, 37 to 39. John 7, 37 to 39. Look what the Bible says. In John 7, 37 to 39, notice what the Word of God says. Are you there? The Bible says, and in the last day of the great feast. Now, by the way, I want to just show you one thing. Everything that we're talking about right now, from Psalms 23 on down to Isaiah 55, everything that we're talking about is in the sanctuary. And let me just break this so you can get the vision in your head. When we talked about walking with God, we were talking about prayer. You were at the golden altar. When we talked about the idea that you had to have the table, you also have to realize that in the sanctuary you have the table of showbread, which represents bread of his presence. And we're going to find that now we're thirsting. But the Bible says, in the sanctuary, where do you drink at? Where do you drink? Let's see. Let's go a little closer. The Bible says in John chapter 7, verse 37, 39, in the last day of the great feast, Jesus stood crying, if any man thirst, any man what? Thirst. That sounds like Isaiah 55 now, doesn't it? Ho, everyone that what? Thirsteth. Look what he says. Come unto me and drink. Guess what? Guess who the water is? Jesus is the water first. But he's going to give us the Holy Spirit, which is also water. Remember Jesus said, the woman at Jacob's well, You remember her? What was the story about that? Anybody remember the story of the woman at Jacob's well? John chapter 4? Keep your finger right there in John 7. Come right back. Come on, John chapter 4 with me. Come on. All right? Listen where the water comes from. Listen carefully. John chapter 4, and I'm going to look here at verse 9. Then saith the woman of Samaria, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Verse 10 said, Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee what?
Living
waters. Keep that in mind. The woman said unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with. The well is deep, and from whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us this well to drink thereof? And it says, himself, and his children, and his cattle. Then Jesus answered and said, whosoever drinketh this water shall what? Thirst again. Now what water is that that keeps you thirsty?
Physical water.
Physical water. Oh, and let me break it down to you this way. The water that the world offers. Okay? The lifestyle that the world offers will leave you hungry and it will leave you thirsty. That hunger and thirstness, that hungriness and that thirsty attitude that you feel is the emptiness when you have done everything under the sun and you're not satisfied. There's something there that is just empty. You can go to and this is what I told you before, you can go to a club, you can be at a party, you can have a wonderful girlfriend or boyfriend, and yet there's something there that's just so empty, you just can't even explain it. You just feel like, sometimes you just get the point, man, I just feel like I could be alone, or I don't feel like I'm in love with nobody. It's an emptiness, because God, that emptiness is a thirst. But it's a thirst that the world can never satisfy. No music, no song, no drugs, no drinking, no sex, no whatever you want to yield to will satisfy that thirst. That thirst, it can only be satisfied when you realize your need for a Savior.
Amen.
And you understand God's love for you. That's what changes you. Coming to church does not change you per se. What changes you is the listening of God's word and you reasoning in your mind to say, you know what? I think it's time for me to follow you, Lord. I've done everything under the sun. I might as well now go all the way with you. I am tired. I want to commit suicide. Sometimes I want to do overdose on drugs. I want to do pills. I want to drive the car into a wall. I'm stressed out all the time. Lord, if you don't help me, nobody can. That's the attitude of those who are thirsty. Those who are not thirsty think their life is grand and everything is okay. No matter, and as long as I got money and I got a good man and a good husband or whatever the case is, or a good wife, I'm fine. They're not thirsty yet. When you really get thirsty, nothing will satisfy you. When you really get thirsty, you will seek God. You will seek, and what really gets you is, I went to church, but I'm not getting anything. Because sometimes the pastors are not pointing you to the water, the fountain of living water that you need to have. And they're not revealing to you what you need to hear so that you can see that the water of life is beckoning you. Come, I can satisfy your emptiness. I can satisfy your thirst. That's what it's talking about. But going on right quick, look what it says here, right quick. But it goes on and says this here. Jesus said, but the water that I shall give him, the water that who?
Christ.
That Christ will give, shall be in him a well of water springing up to what? Everlasting life. Sound familiar? Watch this, by the way. If you don't believe that, now go back to John 7:37. Remember what you just read? I will give him the water that I shall give him shall be a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Like water verily coming up out of a rock, just constantly springing up. Jesus said, that's the type of water I will give you. In other words, once I give you water, you will never be empty again. You will never have those desires for suicidal tendencies anymore. You will never feel like your life is worthless and that you don't have nothing else that's worthwhile. You will find a new type of joy. You will find a new type of desire. I will give you new motives. I will show you what you can become through the grace of God. Not what you are, not what you used to be. I'm going to show you what I can make of you. That's what God will do. Thirsting. Look at here. Look what the Bible said in John 7:37. The Bible says in John 7:37. We went back now. Let's go back. The Bible says here, and it says here, making its point. The Bible says, in the last day of the great feast, Jesus stood saying, if any man now thirst, let him come unto me and drink. Now, what did he say about the water? What did he say to the woman about the water that he would give? You will never thirst again, and it will flow. You'll be like a living well of water, constantly springing up. Remember, listen to this carefully. Verse 38: He that believeth on me, listen to how the thirst is quenched. Listen, he that believeth on me, as the what? As the scriptures have said. Listen carefully now. Said, out of his belly shall flow what? Rivers of water. Now, what is this rivers of water that's going to be flowing out of you constantly? Listen what the Bible says. To show you that the brother was also showing the point that the water was the Holy Spirit, listen what the Bible says. The Bible says, this spake he of the Spirit, for they that believed on him should receive. What they're going to receive? The Holy Spirit. And the Bible says, for the Holy Ghost was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. But now wait a minute. So thirst is a thirst after what? Righteousness. But in thirsting after righteousness, you have to drink what? Water. And the water that you need is the water of the what? Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is responsible for you being born again. And only when you're born again, after you have initially drunk of the water, do you constantly go after the water again and again. And the water gives you spiritual strength, it gives you spiritual discernment, it gives you power to resist, and it gives you a desire to love and work for God. You would never do it if you were not born again. You would never do it if the Spirit of God wouldn't prompt you. Because in the natural heart of man, his heart is in natural rebellion against God. So we need to understand. But let's go one more step, let's look one more. So we found out now, ho everyone that what? Thirsteth. Isaiah 55:1 now, going back there. Ho everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the what? Water. In other words, come ye to the water. Who's the water? Jesus. And what will he give? He will give you living water. What's the living water? The Holy Spirit. Most of Adventism today is in need of water. Living water, the living water of God's Holy Spirit in their lives. But let's go more step further. Now, notice it says, come ye to the what? Waters. Ye that have no money, come and buy and eat. How do you buy without money? How do we buy without money now? That's the text. I mean, you got it right there in front of you. Some of you got, so I know everybody got iPhones now and Bible, electronic Bibles, all kind of stuff nowadays. So you got it right in front of you, and you got all them dictionaries. You should know what this is. How do you buy without money? Because it said, come and buy and what? Eat. In other words, you can't eat unless you buy. So it's something you have to buy so you can eat. All right? Won't you get it? Oh, how do you buy Christ? Because it's come unto me, so it's Christ, but how do you buy him? And by the way, what are you going to buy?
You're going to ask for the gold of faith and love, Okay. Christ's righteousness, okay. Spiritual
okay, now he's quoting Revelation 3:18, because that's connected to what we're talking about. But you're right on the point. You're right there. Right, look closer. I'm going to help you out. We're going to fix up what he just said. How are you going to buy? First of all, the Bible says, go with me in your Bibles to Proverbs 23:23. Proverbs 23:23. We're going to see how we're going to buy in just a minute. But you got to know what you're going to buy from Jesus, right? What are you going to buy from Jesus? I mean, you don't go to the store and just buy anything you see. when you go to a store, you buy specific things, isn't that right? I need cereal, I need bleach, I need washing powder, I need a new dress, I need some new shoes. When you go to the store, you buy specific things, isn't that right? So Jesus says, buy of me, but he's not leaving you blank. What are you going to buy? Proverbs 23:20 says, buy the what? Truth, and sell it not. Some specific things you have to buy from Jesus. And the Bible said they're in a nutshell called what? Truth. Now, why did I say specific things? What is truth? Because the Bible says you must buy truth. And then we're going to see how you're going to pay for the truth. Are you ready? Okay, how are you going to actually make the payment? All right? You're going to buy truth. It's like being in a store and you say, wow, that's a nice dress. I could wear that on Sabbath. Or that's a nice suit, man. How much is that suit? Man, how much money? You haven't done that before? So why are you looking at me like, listen, okay, all right? Think about it now. Think about the same thing. What I'm trying to show you is object lessons in the natural world that the Bible is trying to show you, that the Bible is not difficult to understand. God is giving you constant object lessons when you think about words. When you think about the word buy, you think about the idea that you go buy. How do you buy? What do you buy? Do you just buy everything in a shop, or do you specific things you buy? Do you give your husband a list and say, go buy everything on aisle A, B, C, D, and E? Or do you say, go get flour, go bring me some corn? The Bible says, okay, God says, you got to buy from me. Jesus, what am I going to buy from you, Jesus? Truth. All right? So is there a certain brand? Or is it just one truth? Let's see what the Bible says. What is truth that I got to buy? Look what the Bible says, John 14:6. Jesus says what? I am the what? The way, the truth, and the life. No man come unto the Father but by me. So the first thing you're going to buy is Jesus. But what are you going to buy from Jesus? Character. Let's go a little closer. So you're going to buy Jesus and character. That's one. Let's go a little bit closer. But now what else is truth? John 17:17. The Bible says, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. So now you're going to buy what? The word of God. Because that's also what? Truth. But now, what else you gonna need? Okay, I got my cart with the word of God. I got my cart filled with the character of Christ. Now, what else do I need to buy? All right, I need to buy the Holy Ghost. Because the Bible says that, John 16:13 says, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into what? All truth. So now I've bought Jesus, I bought the word, and I bought the what? Holy Ghost. But now, is there anything else I need? Is there anything else I'm going to need? Well, let's look at this one for a moment. Are the fruits of the Spirit truth? Because I'm about the Holy Ghost, but I got to make sure I can carry, put on the fruits. Is that right? The Bible said in Ephesians 5:9, but the fruit of the Spirit is all goodness, righteousness, and truth. So is the Holy Ghost and the fruits. So I got some fruits in my basket too now. Are you with me now? Now, let's. What else I need? Is there something else I need? Yes, one more thing. Psalms 119:151. The Bible says, thou art near, O Lord, and all thy commandments are truth. So now the Bible said, by the what? Commandments of God. By the truth. Now once I got Jesus, his word, the Holy Ghost, the fruits, and the truth, the Bible says, sell it not. Now, but I'm coming now to the cash register. How will I pay for it? And what will be my experience after I get the groceries home? Come on now, how will I pay for it? Now the Bible says, so then, watch this now. The Bible says, buy of me. Earlier we said, buy of me means we have to believe in him, isn't that right? But belief is also called faith. How are you paying for these groceries? By faith and obedience. Are you with me now? You're buying it by faith and obedience. Romans 10:17 says, so then faith cometh by what? Hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Are you with me now? So when you hear the word of God, buy of me, and you're going to buy character, you're going to buy the word, you're going to buy the Holy Ghost, and you're going to buy the fruits of the Spirit, and you're going to buy the commandments of God, and you're buying it all by faith, but the desire and the will to what? Obey what's written, then what will be your experience after you bought the food? After you buy the spiritual food. Look at Romans 6:18. And ye shall what? Here we go. Come on. It's right there. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Wait a minute. The word know means to know with personal acquaintance and experimentation. So what is it, when you buy food, do you buy food to let it sit on the shelf, or do you buy food to eat? So when Jesus said, buy of me, you bought truth, you didn't buy the truth so it could sit on your table. You didn't buy the truth so it could sit in the closet on the cabinet. You didn't buy that type of, you bought food that you could cook. Most of the time when people buy food, groceries a lot, it's because they buy the food and cook it, and then they get some more. Is that right? Come on now, talk to me. The Bible says when you buy of God, you're supposed to be eating constantly of the food. So if I'm eating and taking on his character day by day, I have to keep getting more. Isn't that right? So I have to keep going back to the spiritual storehouse, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. And I, Lord, I need to buy some more character development. I need to correct this defect here. I need to buy from you. I need to buy some more promises here. Are you understanding me now? You're looking at me like I lost my mind. I'm telling you exactly what the Word of God is teaching us about buying and buy ye that have no money, come and buy me. You don't have any money. So how do you buy from God? You buy by faith. But faith without works is dead. So it's a faith that leads to obedience to everything God has said. So you're buying by faith. What are you experiencing? What do you mean? Let's go a little bit closer. Look what the Bible says. In 2 Timothy 3:16, it says, all scripture is given by what? Inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in what? Righteousness. Stop. The scriptures give instruction in what? So every time I buy the character of Christ, every time I take on the Word of God and I study the Bible, what am I experiencing? Righteousness. But how am I experiencing it? By faith. So what am I buying from constantly? I'm buying righteousness by faith. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire. Oh, you missed it. Wait a minute. See, if some of you hadn't hit your mind, buy of gold tried in the fire, what's that talking about? That's talking about, what is gold? Let's break it down. What is gold now? Turn with me in your Bibles, first of all, to 1 Peter 1:7. 1 Peter 1:7. Okay? 1 Peter 1:7. What does the Bible say? Somebody can read it for me with a loud voice if you got it. Loud voice. 1 Peter 1:7. I want you to see it.
That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ.
Notice the Bible said that the trial of your what, everybody? Your faith. What? How does faith come? By hearing. Hearing by the what? Word of God. So that the trial of your faith, so your faith is represented as gold. Revelation 3:18, I counsel thee to buy of me gold. Same thing. Gold that's what? Tried in the fire. What does the Bible say is tried in the fire? Look what the Bible said in Romans and 1 Peter 1:7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perisheth, though it be tried with what, everybody? Fire. The Bible said your faith, my faith, will be tried by fire. By trials and difficulties. You know, you come into church and now you're in the church for a while and you say, man, you know, since I've joined the Adventist church, all hell done broke loose on me. Everything is happening to me. Why is this happening to me? Let me tell you why. Your faith is being tried. In other words, it's not an intellectual assent now. It's not about the idea that, oh, I just believe because everybody else keep the Sabbath, I'm going to keep it. You will be tried individually to see if the knowledge that you have will actually sustain you in the midst of a crisis. When the man said, look, John, you got to come in on Sabbath. We can't let you off anymore. Now, John, we did it for years, but now, you know, things are tight. Economic situation is very tight. You have to come and work on Saturday. And John, if you don't come in, we're going to have to let you go. And you got to say now watch this. Now watch this. This is when you want, you know, we read this text in 1 Timothy 2:15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You know what the word approved means? The word approved means that God, you're not approved because you read. You're not approved because you got the knowledge now. That's not when you approve. You are only approved when the knowledge you have so takes possession of you that in the midst of a crisis, when the man says, work or get fired, you say, if you're going and fire me, I will not turn my back on my God and his Sabbath. Now, you know what? You understand me now? I'm making it very plain to you now. Because the Bible says you must stand approved of God. Approved of God is not just based on what you're thinking. Oh, well, I studied my homework. I did it all. Oh, I got the Sabbath school lesson. Oh, I got the argument. I can beat brother so-and-so next Sabbath because I got the argument for him right here. No, that's not what it's about. The issue is the knowledge that you obtain is supposed to give you courage to stand when you're tested against that which God has told you to do. And if you fail that test, God will bring it again and again and again until you pass it. And let me tell you something. Every time he brings it, it'll be a little bit harder than the last time. Because he's going to see if you really going to believe what you really got faith in what you believe. And then in the midst of it, you're supposed to claim a promise. What do you do when the employer says, hey, man, you going to work or get fired? You know what? That one employer told me that. He said, look here, Barry, you're a good man, but you got to have to come in on Saturday. I said, no, I can't come in on Saturday. Well, you know, that means you don't get fired. I said, yeah, the same God that made the heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of water can also create me another job. Amen. And my employer thought I was crazy. He said, man, you're crazy. I said, no, I know my God. And I said, let me tell you something. Your job only exists because of his love for mankind. And at any time he sees fit, he can cut your job and your whole company can go down. But you don't think like that. You're thinking, oh, if I lose this job, God, what type of God do you think you serve? You think you serve a mamby-pamby God? Well, you know, you think God is a good luck charm? You know, Lord, help me keep my job. Huh? Is that what you're doing? Nuh-uh. This is not what it's about. Let me help you out. When you are serving the God of heaven, the Bible said you're serving the creator of heaven and earth. That made the sea and autumn. We keep the seventh day Sabbath and we say it's the memorial of creation. And yet when the man tell you you're fired on a job, you come out of your home. Honey, I lost my job. I don't know what I'm going to do. You don't need to be. Somebody just, you know, somebody just get a little smack. Get a grip on yourself. Hold on a minute. Who do you serve? You serve the living God. You're not serving Buddha. You're not serving some statue like a Mary to sit there like this. You're serving the God that made heaven and earth. And that God said, I will supply your need according to the riches and glory in Christ Jesus. That God says, fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. How is it that you sit there and walk around with your head down and talk about, I lost my job. I've been there 30 years. Then I'm going to be unemployed. I'm going to be one of 46 million. Uh-huh. But God says, while you off, study my word. While you off, come to the table. While you off, stop complaining. Don't let a tear come from your eye. I will take care of you. I'm young and now I'm old. I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor a seed begging bread. Amen. You go to a job interview and they say, well, I'm sorry, you're the 100th person on this list. And we'll give you a call and you'll go home and you say, Lord, I want this job. But Lord, you know, I love you. But if this job is for me, they say I'm the 100th person on this list. Can you bump me up a couple of notches? And God will not only bump you up a couple of notches, but then when they bring you into the interview, God will make sure that you get your Sabbath off. One man fired me up a good job. He said, man, this job paid $10 an hour. You'll never get another job like this. I said, well, I got news for you. My God is able. He looked at me and said, no, I don't think so, brother. I said, he said, you turned out a good job. You can make that money. I said, no, I'm going to follow my God. I said, the Sabbath is more important than my job. Because when your job fails, the Bible says in Isaiah 40 verse 8, the grass withers, the flowers fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. And as long as I stand on that word, as weak and feeble as I may feel, God will take care of me. Amen. I know what I know. I'm telling you what I know. I'm talking about, listen, it's one thing to read this stuff. It's another thing to have the experience with it. You shall know the truth. You shall experience righteousness. You experience the word of God. You got to stand on it sometimes. Sometimes it's hard. Listen, don't get me wrong. The tears gathered up in my eyes when the man said, you're fired. I'm not going to sit there and play that human emotions didn't have a part. I didn't sit there all the time, just unflinchingly, you know, no, the tears got me. I thought about my family, and I thought about what I got to do when I get home, and why I'm going to tell my wife that I lost my job. What? You know, all those things flitted across my mind, and then a dark cloud came over. Man, if I lose my job, everything's over. Oh man, how are we going to do this? I promised the children. Then it stopped. Then there's like something just shook me, and I said, no. I looked up at the sky. I saw birds flying by. I looked in the grass and I saw a squirrel. And the first thing came to me was, where do they work at? Now that sounds a little strange, but God gives you an object lesson. He brings you in nature sometime. Look at nature. Where does that bird work at? You're smarter than the bird, and yet he fly around. He's fat too, buddy. You don't see birds, you know, they got a strange thing with birds falling out of the air right now, but you don't see birds falling out of the air because they're malnourished, unless they've been a pet. But that God, but our God, sat there and looked at you and said, look at the birds, look at the squirrel, fat, squirting around in there, just sitting there eating a nut. You're sitting in the house with one loaf of bread in the refrigerator, and the squirrel outside, fat, and just eating this nut. And you're in the house, look, scrunching for that one piece of bread. Something's wrong with that picture. Because God said, I'm supposed to be better than the squirrel and the birds. Are you with me now? Consider the lilies of the field. They toil not, neither do they spin. But I say unto you, Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. I'm trying to tell you that God is able. You served, you're keeping God's holy Sabbath. If you've broken the Sabbath, then you need to change your mind today and say, Lord, I will keep holy your seventh day. I will come, I'm thirsty. I don't know how I'm going to make it, but Lord, you will supply my need. I'm still living. You got breath in your body this morning? Why are you here? How did you get up? Where did your breath come from that made you get out of bed this morning? And how can you sit there and say that you did it? You did not make your own breath this morning. You did not draw your faculties back to life when you went to bed last night. God woken you up again. And the same God that woke you up, the same God that gave you breath, the same God is able to supply your need and take care of you, take care of your family. All he says to do is have faith in me. Amen. Today we do everything but that. And we want to know why all of a sudden our blessings get cut short. Because God has to try to train us. Curses the man to put his trust in the arm of flesh. But God calls us to trust in the living God. We got people out here ready to commit suicide because they lost a job. God has 1,000 ways to bless you, which you know nothing. All you got to do is accept the one principle of making his service supreme. And never allow yourself to talk in a hopeless and discouraged way. I have to come back to this because our time is up. Time always flies when you're having fun. But this morning, I wanted to give you this point. If you go to the table, you have the assurance that God will take care of you. Yes. The only reason why you doubt, because you're not at the table. It's nice to be here, but sometimes you got to go to the table. When you're in pain, you got to go to the table. There's sometimes difficulties come and disappointments come that you can't talk about with other people. You can't talk about it even sometimes to your wife or your husband. They don't understand. Them, as much as close as they are, sometimes it's just something about it. Or sometimes they just get the needle in you the wrong way. And you just say, I would talk to her, but she don't get it. He don't get it. And that's the time you got to go to God. You got to find a quiet spot in your house and close the door. And you close that door and get on your knees. And you don't get off your knees if you're a grown man. You don't get off your knees until every tear is shed. Because you don't need to be dying of stress and heart attack. Did you hear what I said, brothers? Older in years, and some of you young men, did you hear what I said? You don't need to be dying of stress and heart attack. I'm a man. I got to take care of my family. I can't do it. Everybody's late. You got 46 million people laid off, and you're worrying about, and this is normal, right? And everybody keeps saying, go get a job. Excuse me? Where are you living? The United States, what's happening right now? Jobs are getting kind of what? Scarce. And not only that, we got laws coming in that's making most of our jobs that went overseas, our middle class is being destroyed, and you're sitting up here walking around town, and you're up here beating your husband upside the head, beating your wife upside the head. You need to go get a job. Who what? You want me to go to Walmart? I'm used to making $100,000 a year, and now you want me to make $6, $7 an hour? Now, if I have to work like that, fine, but don't sit there and expect that everything is just as normal. Listen, what's going on in our society right now is not normal. No matter what the news is telling you, Obama said 250,000 jobs were brought, 250 million jobs, 250 million jobs were brought in, but you got 46 million. Come on, there's something wrong with this picture. Hold on now. And then the jobs are they in the private sectors? Huh? Come on, talk to me now. You sit up here worried. Listen, we gotta end this. But we're sitting here worried about your future, your economic future, your job right now. Some of the burden is so great. Some of you have been walking around all week with it. Some of you have lost your jobs too. And some of you have been tempted and pressured to work on Sabbath. Holy Ghost, no, I'm not in your house. I don't know nothing. All I'm simply telling you is hold your head up for a moment and think about your God. And notice if you stand for God, He will stand for you. Amen. Yeah, you're going to be tested, but you don't give up. God didn't bring you this way for you to lose your way and go back to the world and go back to that lifestyle that was in darkness that you lived. Hustling and bustling and lying and stealing and everything else under the sun. God didn't call you into the church to go back to that. He called you in this church so you might understand His will and have His character reformed in your life. And that you might get a peace of mind and find joy for the first time. And find out your joy is not in music, it is not in the flesh, and it's not in everything that the flesh offer. But your joy is finding Jesus and finding that in Jesus I can have a peace of mind. I can have somebody I can trust. I can have some comfort for a while. I can have some real love, and I don't have. And it's not all about feelings and hugging and kissing and touching and sex. I can find some real love for a change. Somebody who loves me unconditionally when I'm ugly, not just when I'm pretty. If I get hit by a car, he's still the same. I'll just give you like this in closing, let's close you out with this right quick. My wife, a few years ago, got in an accident that disfigured her face. She told me I hadn't seen her about 6 months. She said, I don't want you to come. I want you to come on one hand, but I don't want you to come on the other hand. Because I'm not pretty anymore. I used to call her pretty and everything. Well, I told her I didn't marry you because of how you looked. I married you for who you are. And so I took a flight from America to South America where she was at. When I saw my wife, she was standing on one side. The normal face was like this. You could see this side, normal, hair pushed back. Then she said, honey, and she was kept leaning to the side, and she turned around, she had this big bandage on her face, and her face, all this was out like this. And she looked at me with a tear in her eye and said, I don't know how this happened, but this is what happened. And I told her, I said, I still love you. And we're going to get through this. I didn't say you're going to get through this, I said we're going to get through this. And your faith, you're going to get healed. And I said, you're going to be okay. And we're going to stay married. I said, you hear me? She went to all the doctors throughout South America. They couldn't find out what it was that caused her face such disfigurement. And hard, you could touch it, like feel like a piece of, like a brick. We got on our knees and we had to pray. I only had a few weeks there because I had to return. And she would have to stay. This is a long story, this. Maybe one day I should tell the story. But one thing I'll say is this. Every night I pray for my wife. Every night I believe that God would make a way. People would tell me, man, she went to one doctor, he said, he looked at her and said, Oh my goodness, they said, we can't do nothing with her. Send her home right away. She's going to die in her sleep. Because whatever she has will either go to her brain and cause an aneurysm, or will come to go down her throat and she will suffocate in her sleep in the middle of the night. I said, she's not going to have aneurysm. She's not going to suffocate. Do you hear what I said? I said that because I'm having faith in God. See, the looks are gone now. What am I in love with? A body or a woman with a personality? What am I really in love with now? I'm in love with a person. What are you in love with? Closing. The Lord answered my prayer. I took my wife. I started doing natural treatments on her day and night. Took her off all the medication they had her on. And we went on natural treatments day and night, praying day and night, hours at a time, hours. Sometimes we'd go down, and one time we went somewhere and it swelled back up again, and both her whole face was swollen. Well, God gave me a dream one night. And I saw my wife in a dream. We were driving in a car. Her hair was pushed back. And I saw her face, and her face was down on that side. And then it was just a little mark where the actual thing had been. And I woke up that morning and I told my wife, you're going to get better. And God's going to heal her. And you're going to be just as normal as you've always been. My wife looked at me and said, you think so? And she was kind of sad still. And I said, don't worry. The Lord's going to bless. Before I left there, the Lord blessed us through natural remedies. Her face went down. She had some slowly, you could see the thing happening. And today my wife is here. And I say that because you have to stand on the word of God when everything looks bleak, when everything is against you, when appearances don't favor themselves for you. You've got to stand, and you got to stand because you love. I stood because I loved a woman. If I didn't love her, she told me, she said, some of the men will just leave her from that point. I said, oh, she's through. Because they go by looks and the flesh. But when you really know somebody and you really love them, you won't let them go. Whatever they go through, you're right there. Because your love is greater than just feelings. Your love is a conviction. Because you know who that person is. That's all I'm telling you this morning. Your love for God, your worship for God is a conviction because you know who He is, what He's able to do, and how He loves you and how He will sustain you. Don't give up. Stand for God. He will stand for you.
Amen.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for your love, and your grace that's ever abiding. Please keep us in your care, and help us stand for you, and help us not give ourselves over to the enemy. Give us strength to keep your commandments. Forgive us for breaking your Sabbath. Forgive us for working on your Sabbath. This day, Lord, give us all a new heart and give us a new start, but help us to exercise faith in your promises and stand true and be approved of thee, that we might have the blessing that we seek so desperately. And Lord, feel the hunger, feel the thirst in many a heart this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.